Amitabha. Venerables, in response to this question of, you know, standing up for justice while protecting yourself, your kid, from retributions, it starts with, the world is in a mess. The world is a mess. That's the fact. Many people do not know that behavior hurt the others. But they do not aware enough what they say, what they do, it hurt people. And they were blind to their own conscience. That's because of the negligence, as we mentioned earlier, in educating the next generation about being decent, being caring towards others. Very hard to solve this problem from the root. The first thing is, the attitude towards this is, we should not attach to this world. We should understand that this world is getting towards a downward spiral. And even though it's quite depressing hearing this kind of analysis, but there is a slither of hope. There's a, you know, if we change our attitudes in face of this, our mindset, it's actually a positive thing. Because we cannot attach to this messy world, attach to this world that has lost its way of decency and kindness. We have strengthened our vow to change our environment that we live in. That means we want to go to Pure Land even more in face of this. Nothing worth loving, I mean, nothing worth attaching about in this world. So that's one kind of attitude we can look at. However, we still have to live in this world. We still have to survive. We still have to do what we need to do. So there's a saying in Confucius teaching. If we saw something unjust, 见义不为无勇者. So if we saw something unjust and ignore it, our courage is lacking. We are cowards, basically. Besides, our conscience will blame us for allowing the kid to be bullied, for allowing perpetrator to get away, and to allow this kid to be continue to be, you know, under this emotional trauma. So it requires wisdom to get a very positive outcome out of this. So in this context, it requires wisdom to know how to protect ourselves or protect our kids while still enabling them to stand up for justice, to point out the perpetrator and receive their appropriate punishments or appropriate education. First is the age range. It has many contexts, many scenarios. So one factor we need to think about is how young, how old is the kids, are the kids. Younger, the easier, the older, the harder, basically. You know, they get older, they're more sturdy. Sometimes you can't even, you know, restrain them. They might do something more damaging. Second thing is the parents and teacher. So second factor is the managers, you know, the teachers in class, the parents at home. Parents should be able to, you know, protect, provide assistance to teacher to you know, correct the cultures in the school. So that's what's supposed to happen. So teacher, depends on the teacher, and the class. If the teacher is able to hold a rein, control this situation, that means they will be able to first avoid vendetta, avoid this kind of retributions between the kids. And second is to educate the kids what is right and what is wrong. Basically, you know, this is not a right thing. And the kids listen. And also protects the kids from each other as well. It's hard. So that's why reality is right and ideas. However, if the teacher lost control of this, then parents should step in and help, you know, assist by at the side to help the teacher to, you know, to de-escalate the situation, to make this class culture a bit better rather than a, you know, strong bullies the weak. The goal is to ensure that the witness should be protected, or the kid who stood up for justice should be protected, while the perpetrator is, educated, able to repent their mistakes and correct themselves. However, as Venerable mentioned in the first question, Rome is not built in one day. You know, the iceberg is not formed within three night. Nothing happens without time. And with these long hours of accumulation of negligence, you can't correct this kind of attitude suddenly. You can't just expect they will become are kind and good people. So being wise is very important in this context. 阿弥陀佛。
当然你可以感觉、哦、这个当父母的这个天下父母心啊，还是会比较担忧孩子、哦、在目前的这个社会状况。那我们刚刚谈到安心呢，所以无量寿经当中释迦牟尼佛还特别要赞叹观世音菩萨，众生若有急难恐怖啊，但知归命观世音菩萨，无不得解脱。所以把观音菩萨的愿力啊要告诉孩子。他往后遇到这种比较危难比较恶劣的行为的时候啊，都懂得自诚念观音菩萨。这个感应不思议都能够逢凶化吉这个也很重要。
So being a parent, we always want to protect our children. To be at peace in this situation, you know, mentally as well. We have Infinite Life Sutra, who taught us that if any beings are in dangers, like life or anything,chant the name of Guan Yin, you know, the name of Guan Yin, the Bodhisattva Guan Yin, and these beings will be able to be relieved from the immediate dangers that face them, that threatens their life or threatens their way of life, threatens them immediately. So chant the name of, teach the children to chant, have the habit of chanting Namo Dabe Guan Sin Busa, Namo Guan Sin Busa.Basically, just chanting the name of Guan Yin to get out of this trouble. Because the vow of Guan Yin is there. It's not empty words. It has that effect. Yeah. Helps people arrive in the way. Sufuya, would you like to
ask? 下一个问题了。
好。最后一个了，其实在这边，病者在生病的时候，因为身体痛苦，念不进去佛，只有在身体状态好的时候，才能更愿意念佛，怎么办？伊迪师姐发问啊，伊迪Dharma sister ask when someone who is fallen sick, because of their pain.Because of the pain endured by the body, they can't concentrate on阿弥陀佛. Only when the condition gets better will this person be able to chant阿弥陀佛. So what should we do in face of this situation? 阿弥陀佛.
这个佛呢也是告诉我们了，人生有八苦啊。生老病死，怨憎会，爱别离，求不得，五阴炽盛啊！这个病苦的折磨啊，真的是挺难的。所以啊，我们的亲人有这个病苦啊，我们首先要感同身受，就是能理解他的痛苦。这样我们的言语啊，就会让他感觉你很能理解他。这个病得很苦的人呢，是心灵上是很希望别人能理解到他，体会到他。所以首先这个病苦真的是挺痛苦的。那我们作为家人呢，那我们自己啊要尽到我们的力啊，那比方说从身体上可不可以有医学的手段 帮助他减轻痛苦。那当然中医啊有很多手段啊，甚至于包含呢，我们懂一点经络啊，它都有相对应的经脉啊，能够多帮他按压缓解这个痛苦，那这个是我们可以做得到的。周医师有讲一个系列的课啊，里面都有教这些穴道的按摩啊。你了解之后可以知道哦，可能你这个亲人他主要的病在哪里啊，然后在这些比较重要的穴道啊，可以多帮他缓解按压啊。当然能够再去做一些针灸啊，好的医生的一些治疗，应该都会有一定的缓解啊。当然在饮食当中呢，就还是要注意了，不要又增加他的病痛啊。所以家人生病啊，对我们来讲也是一个净缘，我们怎么净到我们的心，净到我们的力。那从身体上啊，我们能透过医疗的手段方法帮他减轻痛苦啊，心理上啊也感同身受，常常给他一些安慰啊，他可能心里会产生一些什么烦躁的念头啊，我们都可以啊用柔软语啊，用一些经教，但是是柔软的哦，让他比较能接受啊。但这些言语他能接受了，可能有一些烦恼，他就比较能够转，能够放得下来啊。而且我们也要不厌其烦的去提醒、去劝哦。啊，你不能劝了一次了，他有反复呢。哎呀，我都跟你讲过了，你怎么讲不听呢？这个人在很痛的时候啊，他是控制不住的啊，那变成我们要不厌其烦的啊。那包含生病了，病得很痛的时候啊，这个我们也要安慰。当然这些话呢，讲在前面是更好。就是我们过去生都有带业力来，纵使我们这一生学佛了，也不代表说我们所有的业果都不现，它有可能是重罪轻报了。一个典型的例子，玄奘大师，这个在佛门的贡献呢，算数一数二的了。对，可是他年老了，也病得很重。他老人家起个念头啊，哎，我是不是啊经翻错了，才会有这么严重的病啊？后来菩萨来安慰他，告诉他，你翻的都对，但是因为你过去生当过国王，杀业很重，你说这个都不知道几世前的，所以因果是通三世的。所以这是属于重罪轻报，可能这个对病人来讲他比较能释怀，也不容易纠结，更不会产生对因果的怀疑。哦，那假如他病重的时候一怀疑了，那对他就很不利了。哦，这是从心理上安慰啊，理得心安嘛，用义理安慰他啊。好，那第三呢，从灵性方面，因为毕竟是有业力造成的，那这个 无微不施啊，得健康长寿嘛。那现在病得很重的人，可以多放生。啊，甚至于家里的人，假如看了长辈生病了，他心里难受，你说你吃素啊？对爸爸、对妈妈啊，对这个家人啊有好处，啊，那可能你就借这个缘，可能有一些家人他就发心了，哦，哎，当然就是顺势，不是勉强的，哦，那这些亲人因为他吃素了，这功德啊，对于生病的人，他都是增上缘，他都有功德的。好，那这个放生呢？大智度论有提到，啊，诸功德中啊，放生第一，啊，因为众生最爱惜的是生命，啊，你把他从刀口下救出来了，哇，那这个众生对你的感恩是非常强烈的，啊，那这个。多放生啊，吃素啊，保护生命，这个对亡者会有，对于病者有帮助。啊，这个功德力呢，会比较明显，啊，让他痛苦减少。哦，我们也有听过一些同修，啊，他病得很厉害，啊，给他做一次放生，啊，哎，他就比较明显。痛苦有减轻的状况，就这个感应啊，还是明显的，可以感受到。啊，因为你病这么重啊，都有一些冤亲债主在干扰，所以我们家里的人呢，能自诚去放生啊，带病者啊，然后呢，还要为病者啊，当然他病者自己也要忏悔。那是最好，啊，那我们在放生的时候也带病的人做忏悔，啊，跟他这些有缘的众生呢化解，啊，那跟这些有缘众生呢都结西方缘，啊，我们念无量寿经，念地藏经啊，劝他们啊回向这个极乐世界。求生净土啊，冤冤相报，没完没了了，这样解决不了问题了，好，那佛门常说世事是好事啊，我们也用更积极的态度啊来面对这个情况，其实这个我们在人世间呢。世间人都觉得，啊，享福是好事啊。其实享福就是把福报花掉而已了。啊，什么是好事呢？你用非常正确的心态去面对，什么事都是好事。你心用对了，都没有坏事情了。啊，你比方说今天你福报现前了，你把心用对了。你会给众生去想啊，你不会自己来挥霍掉啊，啊，那好事了。好，哎，今天面对逆境恶缘，啊，我们知道，这是过去的业，我们逆来顺受，那这个业就消掉了，无债一身轻了。啊，有可能这个病者现在病得很痛苦，这个都在消业了。啊，他假如很正确的心态面对，有可能消消消消到临终的时候，反而障碍小了，都有可能的。哎，这我们都求佛菩萨三宝加持啊。好，我们看地藏经，婆罗门女，她的母亲造地狱业，哎呀，这个是很不好的事啊。可是呢，婆罗门女，她的心很好，她一片自孝。你 你看他母亲堕地狱的缘呢，居然让他一心一意把他母亲啊从地狱超拔出来。不只是这样啊，他借由这个缘呢，他更发广大心了，为这些罪苦众生，尤其堕到三恶道、堕到地狱的众生，他都要去救度他们。一个母亲堕落的缘呢，业报现前的缘，所以我们假如善用心，有可能我们家里的人很病得很重啊，可能就变成我们孝心整个把它发出来啊，甚至是慈悲心呢、啊，也这个借这个机缘发出来。更好的效法婆罗门女，一日一夜就念到一心不乱了，好，就念到你一心不乱了，以自己的神通力啊，就去到地狱了。哎，这是《地藏经》教的了，做不做得到？天下无难事，只怕有心人了。佛事门中有求必应的，然后这个很可能这个真善缘，对我们都是很大的帮助。好，阿弥陀佛，
阿弥陀佛，感恩师父。